live from the 2014 AES show in Los Angeles, California. Audio-Technica presents Ask Me Anything. And now, here is your host and moderator, Jeff Simcox.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to our second session from the Audio-Technica booth, Ask Me Anything. We are honored to have in the booth with us now producer-engineer Michael Beinhorn. A little bit about him, if I may. Across his accomplished career, producer Michael Beinhorn has worked with some of the biggest names in rock and beyond, including Herbie Hancock, Marilyn Manson, Soundgarden, the Red Hot Chili Peppers, and Hole, just to name a few. Among these artists, Beinhorn is credited with producing many of their career records, including Superunknown by Soundgarden, Celebrity Skin by Hole, and Mechanical Animals by Marilyn Manson. In fact, during the week of September 15th, 1998, Beinhorn achieved the distinction of being the first ever record producer to have two records simultaneously debut in the Billboard Top Ten, with Celebrity Skin at number 9 and Mechanical Animals at number 1, respectively. In addition to his success as a producer, Beinhorn can add programmer, performer, songwriter, arranger, mixer, and engineer to his repertoire. He is also an accomplished fine artist and writer, continually pursuing his passion for free, creative expression through as many avenues as possible. Please join me in welcoming Michael Beinhorn.
Yay.
Yeah. Let's hear it for Michael. Okay, so to those of you who weren't here last time, we have someone in the back room there who will be listening to all the questions as we take questions from you here in the audience, and whoever asks his or her back there favorite question will receive an Audio-Technica M50X headphone. So stick around and ask a lot of questions. I don't know. And we are also taking questions via Twitter. So, do we have anybody here? Oh, right out of the gate.
How did you get started in the business?
How'd you get started in the business, Michael?
Well, I was in a band. I played synthesizer, and I lived on people's couches. It's a hard road. It was a very hard road. But I just fell into producing by accident, actually. We started producing records for my band Material with a bassist named Bill Laswell. And one thing led to another, and we did a record with Herbie Hancock, which was his biggest record, at least at that point, and that's where it all started.
Cool. Thank you, sir. Another one?
The new home project studios, does that put in a dent into the business you're in as far as like the professional producer?
Can you qualify that a bit more?
It's easier. There's lower barriers to entry today into the recording field compared to like say 20 or 30 years ago. So how does that affect established people already?
That's a good question. Well, I think I'm trying to restrain myself because I don't want to get up and start throwing things. I'm going to be very diplomatic. I think it's wonderful that the technology exists. I think it's unavoidable that the technology exists. However, I think the way people use the technology is ridiculous. I think it's stupid. I think that the idea that the degree of excellence that goes into actually making a record, the actual commitment, that basically gets stripped away by the ubiquity and availability of technology like that. And I think it has to do more with the mindset around it than the actual technology itself, which I think is wonderful. I think it's just the fallibility of people who use it, basically, who are involved, who think that they are going to get a recording that's comparable to something that took people months of hard work and an immense amount of effort. So there's my answer, such as it is.
Okay. You can feel free to cut loose anytime.
Yeah, I don't think you want to see that.
No need to restrain yourself too much.
I don't think that would be a good idea.
Okay, more questions from the audience. Here we go.
Hey, Michael. Who is one of your mentors that you feel helped you greatly throughout your career?
I was actually talking with someone about this last night. that's an easy one. He was a jazz drummer named Stu Martin, who's a little short guy who had a terrible drug problem. And he also had a resume about as thick as my arm, as thick as my wrist. Like, he played with everyone from Ellington to Basie. It was incredible. He's one of the greatest musicians I ever met in my life. So one day, I knew that he was interested in synthesizers, because he used these two EMS Synth-EAs that he would set up next to his drum kit when he'd play. Do you know what those are? They're these little synthesizers that came in these suitcases, right? They've got a pin matrix board. And he'd set up these programs, and they'd generate these polyrhythms that, because the thing is so random, you can't really find a one. He'd somehow he'd play along with it and turn it into music, right? I've never seen anything like it, even to this day. So I went up to him, and I was like, Stu, you know, there's this place where you can, you know, work with these synthesizers. They were like these large Buchla systems. And the guy turns around and he put me up against the wall for like 2 hours, and he was railing at me. And I was like, I was horrified. And this little guy, you know, just like going off on me, and he just filled my head with so much stuff. I felt like it was going to burst. And he kept going like, you got to give, like over and over again. And everything that he said to me, like, it never left. It stayed with me, you know, up till this point in time. It was one of the most inspiring things I ever heard. Just like 2 hours of this guy who basically did me, this like little 18-year-old kid, like one of the biggest favors of his life, just by straightening him out. You know, it's not about this gear. It's not about, like, the appearance of what all this is. It's not, you know, I mean, these microphones are great. It's not even about that. It's about something much deeper that we have to tap into. You know, and if you don't do that, you're not only not making art, you're not living.
Oh, here. Hang tight.
So he encouraged you, like, to express yourself creatively, you know, to a certain extent?
He didn't have to say it. He didn't have to say it. I knew exactly what he was talking about. When you have someone get in your face like that and do that to you, you know what they're talking about. If you don't know what they're talking about, you're in the wrong business. That's it. That's the bottom line. Yeah, man.
All right. Okay, I got one here from Twitter. Then I'll get to you. Brandy is saying, what do you consider the best moment of your career?
Oh, man.
One of the best moments of your career.
I don't know, man.
Or
like
two.
Every time a take gets finished, and I feel that I've worked with someone who came in to a recording session with a preconception of what they were going to do, and the take is done, and they've been changed through the whole process of doing it, that's always the best moment. And that happens so often. But that's what's supposed to be.
Yeah,
it's always like that. I mean, historically, there have been so many events like that. You know, so many moments where I would hear a recording that someone had done and just be like, wow, that's exactly why I do this. Yeah. Because it's so moving, and it completely takes you over, and there's no thrill in the world that can possibly top it.
Yeah, cool. All right, thanks, Brandy, for the question. Here we go, we have one in the audience.
Yeah, I just want to know if you always knew that music was the direction that you wanted to go in, or did you have other things in mind?
No, I didn't think it was. I started out in fine arts. I thought that I was going to be a medical illustrator back when, people did that. But you don't... Yeah, I mean, it's beautiful artwork as well, but that's what I was really interested in. But I always loved music, And to tell the truth, like, the two, like, forms aren't necessarily separate from one another. They're just, you know, they're just forms. Underneath, it's the same thing. It has the same exact meaning. It's all an expression.
All right. Thank you. Here we go.
Do you have a background with music theory, or is that helpful to a producer?
I think having a having any kind of educational background at all, any knowledge, any skills is crucial. I don't have enough of a background in music theory, but I've got enough to be able to work with people on song arrangement and things like that. And I'm actually in the process of the education is ongoing. So yeah, definitely.
Cool. Thank you. Another one from Twitter. How did you land the Super Unknown gig with Soundgarden?
Well, I'll tell you. I found out that the gig was kind of open. Another person actually had it, from what I was told. But the person who told me that I should try for it anyway was like, man, they haven't completely made their mind up yet. Okay. So I went up to Seattle, and I guess it was Kismet or something. Everything just kind of fell into place, and it worked.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Yep.
George Martin claims he's the fifth Beatle, and Howard Stern says he's just somebody who turned on the tape recorder. Where do you stand on that?
The fifth Beatle and what now?
George Martin was a producer for the Beatles.
Yeah.
Do you see him as integral to their sound, or someone who just was a technical person to turn on the tape recorder?
Oh, I see. Yeah, you know, it's funny because actually, Hillel, former guitarist from the Chili Peppers, said to me one time, "You're like Steve Martin with the Beatles." Yeah. No. Steve Martin. He got corrected afterwards, and he was like, "Oh." That's where I stand on it. If all you do is turn on the tape recorder, then that's your business. Personally, I don't think that producing, I don't think anyone can come into a recording and say that they're a producer if that's all they're willing to do. Unless you're willing to sit and collaborate with the artist and have a real in-depth interaction with them. My own personal feeling is you can't really refer to that as anything other than that as record production. That's my own personal feeling.
Okay, thank you. More questions from the house. Sir.
Hi, yeah, you're kind of known for using modular synthesizers in making records. How do you relate the process of sound design for synthesis to sound designing recorded sounds?
You mean as far as recording stuff that's not incorporating a synthesizer?
Yeah.
It's kind of the same thing, except the tools are different, really. You know, to me, you're working with, you know, in a recording situation where there's microphones, cables, pre's, compressors, EQs, you're selecting an assortment of tools to be able to, in this case, reproduce a sound, but really process it. When I use a synthesizer in a recording, for an example, I generally am processing pre-existing sounds. It's just a whole different way of doing it. You know, I like the synthesizers because there's a different presentation of the harmonics. You're working with different types of distortions. You're able to put sounds against the. To me, one of the great tricks of recording with the various types of distortions is to kind of have one next to the other and to have them both work and not sound like mud. There's a, you know, that obviously just by saying that you're going like this, you know that it wouldn't be an easy thing to do. But you can have many, many tracks of distorted tones, and if you've actually layered them in a way where they work together, you can create this really beautiful matrix of sounds and, you know, harmonic events that also work concurrently with the actual music that you're recording. So it really kind of amplifies the mood of what you're doing. I see the whole process is kind of the same thing.
With the advent of EDM, do you think rock is dead?
EDM?
Electronic dance music.
Well, considering that EDM had its advent sometimes in the mid-70s, probably not. I just think that people aren't making very exciting rock music these days, that's all.
More questions from the house?
Do you think the way that we make records influences the record itself? In other words, does it matter whether it's analog or digital, or is there something more important than that?
Well, I think the answer to both to that is yes, in both cases. You know, the way that we record a record does matter tremendously to the recording, and there is something more than that. There's always something more than that, and it does come down to the heart and the soul of what's being done. I mean, the recording medium really acts as a kind of a bridging tool, you know, a tool that gets the idea from the artist over to the person who's listening. So we hope that the recording medium is going to be, I guess, transparent in a way, or augment the emotional content of what it is that the artist is doing. So it's yes to both.
All right, thank you. David says, what's been your most challenging musical undertaking to date? Thanks, David.
That's a good question, and I'm kind of racking my brain because there have been some really difficult ones. Specifically, I work with a band very recently, and I'm not going to mention any names. I think it would be impolitic, but someone else who was involved in that project is laughing too. It was difficult because there was so much psychological baggage coming into the process. And I find that when people aren't able, well, willing or able, I guess I'll put it in that order, to be able to bypass that, I find that a lot of the best artists are able, will come into a recording process with an immense amount of issues. Because who amongst us is not utterly neurotic? Yeah. You know, find me a person who isn't stark raving mad.
Good point.
Well, you know what the answer is to that. Yeah. It doesn't exist. We're imperfect, and that's fine. But a real artist will come into a project, and they will know the moment when they have to put all that stuff aside and really deal with the matter at hand and do their job, mm-hmm. whatever that is, and just remain open to the, you know, the muse, whatever comes their way, and, you know, and let that happen. And, you know, when you deal with people who aren't willing to do that, who need to, and it's a choice, you know, you're holding on to that baggage, and it makes the process unendurable, basically, because it won't move. Mm-hmm. And for a person in my position whose job is to try and help it along, yeah. it forces me to be in a rut. Yeah. There you have
cool. it. All right, good answer. Yep.
Phil Spector was known as being a very authoritative producer and taking control of the sessions. Do you believe that was too much control or too much authoritarianism, or should a producer kind of go fade into the background and let the artist take more control of the session?
It's really none of my business how anyone else makes a record. And I don't think it should be anyone else's business either. I think the transparency of that sometimes can be as much of a hindrance as anything else. As far as my position on it, I will either take as much charge or remain as much in the background as each individual project requires. I don't feel in my case that there's any kind of set equation that I'm going to apply to each thing that I work on, because that does a tremendous disservice to the recordings that I work on.
Thank you, sir. Another question from the house.
Hey, Michael. With that being said, I know that in the industry you have to have like a tough skin, but what is one of the clients that you really enjoyed working with and you would like to relive that incident?
Relive it in terms of doing it again?
Yeah, exactly. Like,
I have enjoyed so many of the projects that I've worked on. I wouldn't want to relive one of them. And that's not because they were unpleasurable. It's because these are moments in time that you can't repeat. And you shouldn't. That's the whole point of this. The thing that makes a recording unique is the fact that it's something that happened at this unique juncture when these very, hopefully very creative people and very inspired people got together to do something that was meaningful to them. The effects of everything that was going on in their lives, you know, personally, historically, emotionally, it all resonates to that particular point. I mean, it would be wonderful from the perspective of like, oh yeah, I'd like to go back and make a whole bunch of money with artist X. But it doesn't work that way. It couldn't work that way on the projects that I've done, because they're like snowflakes, basically. It's just a perfect little thing that happened one time, and that's it. And you know, fortunately, unlike the snowflake, there's a marker, a milestone of that's there forever. You know,
cool. Thank you. Another question from the audience.
What is your opinion on brick wall recordings?
Say again.
On brick wall recordings.
Brick wall?
Yeah, compression.
Oh, that?
Yeah.
I don't know if it sounds good. if you've made a recording where it was your intent to compress the living daylights out of something, then God bless you. You know, like if you've made a recording though where you wanted to hear transients, where you didn't mind that the overall level of something had to be lower so that the transients didn't distort, and then someone goes in and tries to squash it because that's the way you do it, you know. Yeah, but who says that makes money? It doesn't. That's a misconception. Okay. The only thing that really makes money, if you want to look at it like that, is a truly amazing record. That's the bottom line. And if you compressed it, if you didn't compress it, it's not important. You know, if that's your intent and that's what you want, that's great. If it serves what you're doing, that's wonderful. But if it doesn't, and you want a really high transient recording, and I personally like hearing things go, you know, if it's a drum, I'd like to feel like someone was going like, yeah, exactly. So in that case, if you're going to put a compressor across that, then, you know, then it's an issue.
All right, we have an urgent question from the audience.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I have a question,
I'm
sir.
Sorry.
No, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, I'd get $250,000 budget to do an album. Now those budgets are $50,000, $75,000. Can you do the same kind of great work for that kind of money? Can you make a great album for that kind of money, or is it kind of, as they say, shoveling shit against the tide?
I think it's feasible given the right conditions. I think that I feel like we as artists are being put into increasingly more and more difficult. We're being pushed into more dire straits because people look at recording the way they look at like having a job in finance or working at like, I don't know, working at the sanitation department or something. Like it's a, you know, it's a job. Like we understand the parameters of this. This is how you do it. So this is how you're going to do all these things. You know, but what they don't realize is when you imprint that specificity to something that's not meant to be specific at all, you've completely destroyed what it is. So there are some instances where you can do things for, you know, a budget of $50,000 and have it come out sounding really good. But like then again, there's that old maxim, you know, good, fast, and cheap. You got to pick two, you know. So that's a reality. You and I both know that. And we've also worked on records where we had to spend a fantastic amount of money to do it. because there were so many. Not anymore. Not anymore. Yeah. No, not anymore. But the thing is that what we did and how it came together, the ends completely justified the means. You know? But people are so risk averse now, and they claim that they don't have money to do things, but they don't understand that the more you limit the artists, the less art you're going to get. It's that simple.
When companies are looking for more and more ways to give the songs away and devalue the cost of music, what's it, you know, then you're not going to get a budget to produce it in the first place.
Exactly. And that speaks to an even greater issue where people are in record companies are that's the most profound vote of no confidence that you can have when a record company gives away a song. That's ridiculous. Come on. You know, I mean, what happened to the, like, if you steal our music, we're going to put you in jail? Why, we've got firing squads for people like you. You know, there's no sense to it anymore. It's silly. And people wonder why records don't sell. It's like, come on. You know. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. More questions from the audience?
Hey, Mike, away from your work, what is it that you enjoy as a hobby?
All my hobbies are my work. I like to write. I like to draw. I like to make records. I like to play around with modular synthesizers. All right, I like to spend time with my wife. It's not a hobby, though, is it?
That wouldn't be a hobby, yeah.
No, I don't think that's a hobby. So it's a life choice.
Have you ever worked with Warren Cucurullo?
No, but he's an excellent guitarist.
Okay. A couple from Twitter. What genre of music would you like to work with that you haven't yet?
That's a popular question.
Jeez. I don't know. What?
I did that.
I don't think there is one. I like all the genres I've worked in, and you know, it's more about the artist.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you ever had artistic differences with the band or the artist to the point where you had to walk off or say you don't want your name on the project anymore?
Yeah, and I'm trying to remember when it happened. there are people smiling. I think I threatened to take my name off. In the end, it kind of wound up on because I didn't fight hard enough. But not so much artistic differences, just kind of like, you know, you can't pull your head out of your ass. You're making personal choices that have nothing to do with the creative process, and I can't help.
More from the house. How about, what's the longest time you've ever taken to record a song? From Twitter.
One song. Jeez. I've spent a long time making a record. I don't think that we ever invested a whole lot of time into making individual songs. I've spent like 13, 14 months on a record.
All right, and what are you listening to now?
A lot of ethnic music, a lot of ethnic African music, ethnic Asian music, a lot of Baroque, because as we like to say, if it ain't Baroque, don't fix it. a lot of Renaissance music, or a lot of early music.
I love early music.
A lot of Bach.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right. Okay, we are out of time. Thank you, everyone, for all the questions. And let's thank Michael for joining us. That was awesome.
Thank you.
Who's coming up next? 3:00. Let me check. Yeah, Joe Barisi. So Joe Barisi's coming up at 3:00. Come back and join us. Hang out. We'll see. We'll talk to the people in the back, see who gets the headphone. Thank you, Michael.
You're welcome.
doing at night.